We have no room for hope. We plan and we act. Hope is for dreamers and poets. We have our will and our weapons, and we shall dictate our own fate.
The Primarchs of his Imperium are heavily influenced by the planets and circumstances of their upbringing. Molded on death worlds, feudal empires, and oppressive regimes, the Primarchs are akin in the methods in which they shouldered their respective burdens. Though many would resent their brothers' privileged positions, some would bear their struggle with quiet contemplation, and of all the Emperor's sons, a particular Primarch would incorporate his misfortune to forge his own ideals. Primarch of the 19th Legion of Adeptus Astartes, Corvus Corax. During the scattering of the Primarchs, Corvus Corax would land on the moon of Lycaeus, orbiting the planet of Kievar. The planet was more advanced than most others with which the Primarchs would inhabit. A forge world that gorged itself on the planet's plentiful minerals extracted from the non-atmospheric moon, its harvest mined by legions of slaves. Under the watch of heavily armored guards, the slave labor would consist of criminals, workers who had underperformed on their work quotas, and political opponents of the ruling class. One such slave, Nasturi Ephrenia, would discover the pale infant inside his capsule. The prisoners would raise the child in secret, naming him Corax, translated from Lycaeus' dialect to mean the deliverer. As the Primarch grew, the slaves would teach him skills to defend himself and eventually fight back against their oppressors. Mastering urban warfare, close quarters combat, and demolitions, Corax would become a fierce warrior. It would also be taught philosophical and political theory. With Corax's accelerated maturation, the slaves of Lycaeus would look to him as a symbol, the soon-to-be savior they had desperately waited for. Corax finally grew to be a fierce leader and began organizing the slave labor force into teams of freedom fighters. With each skirmish, his resistance would amass stockpiles of weapons and conceal caches amongst the camps, orchestrating guerrilla campaigns of psychological warfare, riots, and precision strikes. Breaking the morale of their oppressors and draining their garrisons of strength, the resistance numbers swelled, leading to their final assault. Strategically targeting the Lycaeus Defense Force's security points, Corax would lure Kaivar's rulers into a trap. Outmaneuvering the Lycaeus forces with his own battle-forged warriors, Corax destroyed their supply lines and struck the five largest cities of Kievar with atomic mining charges. The charges snuck aboard transport shuttles, their detonation crippling Kievar's factories. Unable to construct materials and facing a critical loss of raw minerals, the tech guilds of Kievar collapsed, tearing themselves apart in the incitement of civil war. Thousands died, nuclear warfare cleansing the planet of its corrupt tyrants. And from the ashes of war, millions of freed slaves would celebrate their emancipation, renaming the moon of the Primarch's resistance Deliverance. That same day, the Emperor of Mankind would arrive. Meeting with his long-lost son, he would converse with the Primarch for a day and a night, appointing him the Primarch of the 19th Legion on the condition that the Emperor would bring peace to Kievar. With the aid of the Adeptus Mechanicum, the world would be transformed. The Black Tower, which once housed the tyrannical guards of Lycaeus, redubbed as the Raven Spire. Fortress Monastery of the 19th Legion, the Ravenguard. Unleashed upon the enemies of the Imperium during the Great Crusade, the Raven Guard would prove to be masters of sabotage and strategy. Regularly deployed by the Warmaster Horus Lupercal to conduct covert operations, sabotage, infiltration, and lightning-fast precision strikes. At the Battle of Gate 42, Corax would lose thousands of Astartes within his legion, most of which had been Terran-born. After the battle, Horus Lupercal and Corvus Corax would never see eye to eye. Unable to reconcile their differences, Corax would refuse to allow the Warmaster to command his forces. The Primarch's continued distrust of Terran-born Astartes had been bolstered, disgusted by their proclivity to enforce the Imperium's will via terror tactics akin to the 8th Legion, the Night Lords. Corax would further hone his legion to uphold their duty to act as liberators of the oppressed, rather than tyrants hell-bent on accomplishing compliance of worlds by any means necessary. Corax would send the remaining companies of his legion that were Terran-born to far-flung regions of unexplored space, further purging his legion's ranks of those not born on Deliverance. Despite this, much to his chagrin, Corax would often be compared to the Primarch of the Night Lord's legion, Conrad Kurz. Not only were the two Primarchs similar in appearance, but they also bore striking resemblance in their methods of waging war. Corax would revile such comparisons as much as the Night Haunter, disturbed at the notion his legion were akin to the Night Lords in their use of mass slaughter. During the Carinae Retribution, the two Primarchs would nearly come to blows over their differences. Yet with the intervention of Jago Sevatarian, first captain of the 8th Legion, no blood would be spilled that day. Yet rivers of blood would flow from the 19th Legion with the betrayal of Istvaan V. The Dropsite Massacre of Istvaan V would break the loyalist legions of the Iron Hands, Salamanders, and Ravenguard. Led by Ferus Manus, Primarch of the Iron Hands, the loyalist legions would be slaughtered by the combined might of 8 traitor legions. Despite being severely outnumbered, the Ravenguard would endure. Corax would face Primarch Lorgar of the Wordbearer's Legion in single combat, impaling him with his lightning claws, yet be prevented from landing the killing blow by Conrad Kurz. Kurz would injure the Ravenlord, yet Corax would escape the battle, wounded, but alive. For the next 98 days, Corax would leave his forces in a grueling guerrilla war. Yet through the cunning and unknowable intent of the Alpha Legion, Primarch Alpharius would allow the Raven Guard an opportunity to escape. Quitting the Istvaan system, Corax would command his legion to return to Deliverance whilst he would travel to Holy Terra to seek counsel with the Emperor. The Emperor knew that the 19th Legion, decimated by the Dropsite Massacre, was now unable to provide the much-needed force of arms to defend the Imperium. Providing Corvus with a psychic vision, the Emperor would show his son the location of a laboratory which housed the infant Primarchs and held stores of their genome. Enduring through the laboratory's defensive system, known as the Labyrinth, Corax would succeed in his task, retrieving the Primarch genomes and entrusting them to his newly appointed chief apothecary, Vicente VI, implanting the genome into fresh recruits. With the aid of Mechanicum Genitor Nexin Orlandrias, Vicente would succeed. 500 war-ready space marines would be crafted in a matter of weeks, yet the 20th Legion would show their hand, infiltrating the laboratory with the intent to steal the Raven Guard's newfound technology. Implanting the genome with a virus, the Alpha Legion would corrupt the newest recruits to the Raven Guard, preventing their legion's recovery. Corvus Corax would utilize his remaining legion forces to conduct surgical strikes of critical enemy weak points for the remainder of the heresy. Compensating for his legion's small numbers, Corax would nonetheless aid the loyalist forces by instigating uprisings within traitor-corrupted worlds, eventually mustering the disparate 19th Legion companies into a united force. When the embers of heresy had finally died, Corvus would comply with the ruling of Rebute Gilliman of the Ultramarines to separate his remaining legion into chapters. Deciding to end the lives of the mutated sons corrupted by the Alpha Legion and locking himself within the Raven Spire to grieve at their loss. A year later, Corvus Corax would leave the Raven Spire and Deliverance, setting a course directly into the Eye of Terror. Corax would exact his revenge for his fallen brothers Ferus Manus, Vulcan, and the Imperium of Man itself. With exposure to the warp, Corvus Corax would be mutated by its strange powers, transforming into a creature of shadow. The being that had once been the Primarch of the Raven Guard would mete out retribution to the traitorous Wordbearers. Engaging in a duel with Lorgar Aurelian, the warp-infused monster would dominate the now demon prince of the Wordbearers. As Lorgar retreated from the battle, Corax would swear to kill his fallen brother, ending his tyranny and absolving his legion of their shame. His final words to his legion on the world of Deliverance, a promise to prevent further ruin at the hands of his traitorous brothers. Never more. The first axiom of victory
is to be other than where the enemy desire you to be. The first axiom of stealth is to be other than where the enemy believes you to be. The first axiom of freedom is that justice without force is powerless. Force without justice is tyranny.
This has been a tale of the great Imperium of Man, read by the Remembrancer. Thank you for supporting the month of Primarch. My next Vox transmissions shall elucidate the sons of the Imperium throughout the millennia. Those who are chosen are influenced by your voice. Speak the Imperial truth and know no fear, for you are the subjects of his Imperium, and the grace of the Emperor lives within you.